Are you ready?
Man that is in honor. Are you getting it? And understandeth not.
I'm not the one that is saying this. It's in your Bible.
A man that has honor.
You have power and you don't know it. You have access and you don't know it. You are blessed and you don't know it. You are delivered and you don't know it. You are healed and you do not even understand it. The Bible says it's like a beast that perisheth. Now look at the description. The Bible says in Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed because of lack of knowledge. Ignorance doesn't excuse a man, not a single person. You're ignorant, you end up living a life of a victim. Now pay attention. He says it's like, the description is like a what? A beast that perisheth. So in other words, God is saying, with all the promises, if you are ignorant, you're just a beast. Are you getting it? And a beast ended up becoming a what? A victim. You end up perishing. So that is why many Christians are stranded, are suffering. Because why? They have all it takes, but they have no knowledge of it. So let me open your eyes now. When God show up to Isaac, he says, I am the Lord God of your father Abraham. Do you know what God was doing? Who can tell me? Thank you so much. God was introducing this himself to this man for him to have knowledge of who God is and the relationship between himself and his father. Because if you don't know, you must know now. You are not an ordinary person. I am the God of your father. God clearly introduces himself to this man so that he could understand what he is about to do. And not only that, he introduced himself to this man, he revealed the covenant. He says, I have already said to your father, in blessing I will bless thee, in multiplying I will multiply thy seed. It is the same word, it is the same promises from Genesis to Revelation between God and man and God and Adam and God and Abraham. So God was saying, this is exactly what's going to happen. If you don't know, let me let you know. If you forgot about it, let me remind you. If you do not understand, let me teach you. If you cannot see this, let me open your eyes. If you've never heard, let me speak to you so that you can hear me now. So God is saying, I am the God of your father Abraham. And not only that, I am the God of your father Abraham, but I have promised that I will bless him and I will increase him. But then look at Psalm 47 or 49, is it? 49 verse 20. It says, ignorant kills a man. You are like a beast that perisheth if you have honor and you don't know it. Praise God. Do you know that this is why many Christians are frustrated? We have thousands of promises in the Bible and yet we're still sick. Praise God. We have God walking behind the scene. We have angels walking behind the scene. We have Holy Ghost walking behind the scene. We have the blood of Jesus walking on our behalf. We have the word of God working on our behalf. We have prayer. We have grace. We have faith. We have anointing. We have everything that it takes for you to become what you ought to become. But you are still struggling behind the limelight. What is the problem? Ignorance. Praise God. What is the problem? Lack of understanding. Let's go back to that verse, Psalm 49 verse 20. Let's go back. I want you to read something deep that is there. Read that for me, please. 49 verse 20. Read for me, please. After two, go. Man that is honor and what? Understanded. That is the word that I want you to take out. Understanding. Understanding. The Bible says, in all thy getting, get what? Understanding. Listen, if I buy you a car and you don't understand how to use that car, trust me, it's just a toy in your house. Amen? If I buy you a motorcycle and you don't understand how it works, it's just a furniture somehow. If I buy you a computer and you do not understand how to use that computer, trust me, somebody else will use it for you. In this Christian race, in this life, you need the word to have understanding to succeed. The reason why other Christians are making it and you are not making it, the difference is what? Understanding. Amen? This young boy, I don't know whether if he's even up to 30 yet, that started off with Facebook. He has understanding about technology. And before you know, he's making millions of dollars. The guy is a billionaire now. And you are a what? You're dealing with 5 cents, 25 cents. Even when you buy groceries, you're begging for the 25 cent change or the 5 cent change. Give me my change. Well, how much is it? 10 cents, 5 cents? Understanding. We're going to have some understanding this morning. Amen? We're going to have some understanding. So, the promise of God came to this man. The revelation of God came to Isaac. The instruction of God came to Isaac in the midst. Take note now. In the midst of the famine, not at the end of the famine. I'm breaking some eggs this morning. Many times we want God to take us away from problem and then show us promise and work it out for us. Hallelujah! I have a testimony. The Lord has done it again. No, it doesn't work like that. In the midst of the problem, that's where God wants you to perform. In the midst of that shame, in the midst of that disappointment, in the midst of that discouragement, in the midst of that trials, in the midst of that sorrow, that's when God look and say, yes, now I want you to demonstrate to the devil that you are my child. That's exactly what he did to Job. That is when God is saying, I want you to show yourself strong. So the promise of the Lord came to him in the midst of famine. It was in the midst of famine that God showed up, and God said to him 6 times, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. 6 times, God, within 2 verses, God says, I will bless you, I will make you, I will perform, I will cause this to happen. Oh, so what else should God do? Now pay attention. This man heard the words from the Lord. And he got the revelation. He discovered the covenant. He realized that there is a relationship between his father and God, and the legacy is still there. And if you see verse 6, and Isaac what? Dwelt in Gerar. Now pay attention. Before you go to Isaac dwell in Gerar, go to verse 5. What does it say? Let's go. Chapter 26 of Genesis, verse 5. What does it say? Read for me, please. Okay, let's take it from verse 4, then you connect to verse 5 so that you understand it very well, what I'm trying to point out. Verse 4. And I will make thy seed to multiply as the stars of the heaven. And I will give unto thy seed all these countries, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. Because, why? Thank you. You see the secret here? The secret come as a result of one man obedience. You see that? So now it's up to him also to obey. His father obeyed the voice of God, and it's up to him to also obey the voice. Listen, the obedience of Abraham gave him the platform for God to visit him. Now it's up to his own obedience for him to see the fulfillment of God's promise upon his life. Praise God. So he says, because that Abraham obeyed my voice and kept my charge, my commandment, my statutes, and my laws. That is, the man was an obedient servant of God. I'm going to point something to you just now. Pay attention. Now, in the midst of this, God wants Isaac now to obey. Not Abraham now. Abraham is gone. Now, pay attention very well. I bet you, if you were Isaac, you will not obey in this area. I'll tell you why. Do you know why, Brother Alex? Because this same God now that showed up to Isaac was the same God that instructed Abraham to slaughter Isaac. Now you're shaking your head. You know what I'm saying? Now you get it. This same God who instructed Abraham to sacrifice his only son, Isaac. Now he's saying,
Now you, Isaac, now your dad has gone. Obey me. Follow me. If you were in his shoes, say me, it was my dad. If you were the one that asked him to kill me, you think I'll forget about that? God, when my dad, he strapped my hands behind my back. He led me on that altar to sacrifice me. And you show up now to tell me what? That I should obey you. Aha. This is where many Christians miss the mark. Lord, where were you yesterday when this happened? Lord, remember all that I went through. In fact, if I blame you, God, I blame you. That's how we behave sometimes. Whatever happened to my wife, Lord, it's your fault. Lord, I can't believe now. I can't believe because of all that I've gone through for the past years. I can't believe because of all my pain, because of all my disappointment, because of all my shame. God, you were there when I went through all of this. And God, you didn't do anything. In fact, you put my life on the edge. And now you showed up and said, Lord, I am your father. And I'm the God of your father. And worship me and serve me. No, Lord, I don't understand this. Where is this coming from? This is where many Christians battle with God. When they beat me up, when they kick me out, when I lost my job, when my wife died, my husband died. Yes, Lord, where were you when they disgraced me? Where were you? Where were you when Abraham took off my clothes and he laid me on that altar? I asked him, I said, Daddy, where are you taking me to? He says, my son. To be fine. Where were you? Praise God. But you know, I love Isaac. He remembered all that. He knew everything about that, but he never said a word. In fact, if you look at that account very well, even he was asking Abraham, where are you taking me? And even when he laid him on the altar, he was willing. He knew there was an altar. But you see, the man, he loved God like his dad. He loved God. He loved God to the extent. Listen, you know what trust is all about? Trust is to say, even if I'm going to die, I still believe and I will not change it. That is trust. You know how Isaac was laid on that altar? Without any fight, because it was not only that Abraham believed God, but Isaac also believed God. He believed. Because he was not a boy at that time, he was an adult man, but he was ready and willing to die for the God of his father. So there was no need to accuse him of yesterday, because there was a testimony in the midst of that. When he was at that altar, God showed up and says, I have proven you. He heard. Whatever God was saying to his father, he heard him. Even the lamb that the Lord brought for him, that they should slay the lamb, that Abraham should slay the lamb instead of Isaac, he saw it. That was when the dad released him and he saw the lamb. And then he said, oh, daddy, so you were planning to kill me for God. Okay, fine. I would have loved to die, but you know, I know this God doesn't eat flesh and blood. Anyways, fine. To God be the glory. Uh-huh. Sometimes as believers, we only want to say amen when it is well. Say, praise God. Hallelujah. It is well. I have a testimony. When you don't have a testimony, will you still say praise God? Will you still say hallelujah? When you are down to zero, will you say thank you, Jesus? You see, that is when, even when a man is married to a woman, right? Or a woman married to a man, a family, the time they prove themselves is when one party or one person doesn't have at all. In the midst of trials, that's when the wife will still say, I will stay with you. Or the husband say, I will stay with you. I love you. I'll still stay. I'll stay. Going nowhere. No, we have kids. We have our father. I will stay. I marry you for better and for worse. There at the end. Listen, such man or woman will look back and say, I will love my wife as much as she loved me. As long as she's alive or he's alive, I'll still love them. Why? Because this was the love that he demonstrated. He saw what God did for his father. Praise God. So now the Bible says in verse 6, and Isaac dwelt in Gerar. He obeyed as his father obeyed. Verse 7.
And the men of the place asked him of his wife. The Bible says the man awoke. And he said, she's my sister. Men with beautiful women were in trouble. Oh. And women with handsome men, you're also in trouble. You always see wahala everywhere you go. Praise God. Why are you talking to my husband? I saw you giving him your number. Who are you? Trouble. If he's an ugly man, you won't mind. Give your number. Praise God. Don't mind me this morning. If your husband has big nose like mine, and it looks like something else, you say, you're talking to him, okay. When you guys are done, meet me at the house. You walk away. But if it looks like Father Christmas, you grab his pants. So where are you going? Why are you talking? What? You want to know every details. Praise God. Hallelujah. So the Bible says Isaac obeyed. And he stayed there. But afterwards he lied. Now something deep that I discover again is this. Now pay attention. If God has promised you to stay somewhere, right? Say stay. Let's be honest. And you believe God. Now we're coming to the human aspect of it. And you stay there. Somebody point a gun at your head. So you're dying today. Are you going to remember the promises that God gave to you? Or you're going to focus on this guy that point this gun on your head? What are you looking at? At that time, your concentration will be on what? On the gun, not on the promise anymore. That's another obstruction. Many times, when we are faced with challenges, we totally forget about Bible. The first thing you think about is your phone. The next thing, my member of the family that will help, you begin to call. Uncle, brother, auntie, I'll talk to my boss, my friend. You call all everybody, and the last person that you remember now is God. Okay, let me pray. God said, after you have done all the marathon, now you remember me. But you know, he's such a loving, merciful God. He will still say, yes, I'll still be with you. I'll still help. Amen. It was God that told him to stay there. It was God that told him not to run away. And now because of fear, there was an issue where the Bible says he feared because he had a beautiful wife. And because of the men around, he knew that they were going to come after his wife. He lied. He says, anybody actually say, oh, you're my sister. His father lied the same way. Abraham lied the same way. Isaac lied the same way. Jacob lied the same way. So it was a fundamental, foundational problem. Praise God. Read your Bible very well. The same sin of Abraham is the same sin of Isaac. The same sin of Isaac is the same sin of Jacob. The life of Abraham, the same life of Isaac, the same life of Jacob. All the trend, all the constraints, all the late childbearing, the same for all three of them. Praise God. Now pay attention. Now when Abimelech discovered that they were playing outside, having fun, romancing, he says, I saw you guys through the window. That's your wife, not your sister. You don't touch her like that. You don't hug like that. You don't kiss like that. It's your sister. Oh, God, now I was afraid. You see the point? And he says what? I thought that what? If I say this is my wife, pay attention now. This is so deep. He says what? I was going to die. Now open your eyes wide now. The revelation is coming. Did God ever told him that he's going to stay there and die? What did God say to him? Before, in verse 3, I will bless you, I will do this, I will do that 6 times. But now, what God did not promise him is what he was saying to what? Abimelech. He was bringing death into the scenario and God never spoke of anything about death. Are you getting it now? Are we learning now? He was saying, I am so afraid because I thought that I would die. If I say she's my wife, they're going to kill me. Did God ever told him that you're going to die in this land? They will kill you for your wife? Who made that up? Sometimes you make things up for yourself that never existed. Pastor, you don't know. You don't know. You don't know. You don't know. Pastor doesn't know nothing and I don't want to know.
Say, Pastor, if you understand, no. You're not in my shoes. Of course, I won't be in your shoes. Amen. Stop making things up that never existed. Stop fearing and doubting and wondering to the extent that you're hurting yourself. Say, I think I will die young. Who told you that? When Adam touched that tree that he ought not to touch and eat of it, God showed up and he says, Adam, Adam, where? They say, I'm naked. God says, who told you you are naked? Who told you? You should not have even said it in the first place. He says, I'm naked. God says, Remember the Bible says, life and death is in the power of your tongue. Whatever God has not said, don't say it. Don't you try it. Don't you? You say, you know, sometimes we can suffer and, you know, this suffer. In fact, we can adjust now. Yeah, you are adjusting to suffering and poverty. Don't know wonder you will die poor. Me, I will not die poor in this land. I will fulfill my destiny in Jesus' name. Say it whatever way. Even if you want to make it religious and say, the Bible says Jesus Christ is a holy Christ. Yes, but it's a rich Christ too. And you know, the Bible says, set our affection on things above, not on things of this life. That doesn't mean you should live a poor life. Sometimes we try to become holy and sanctimonious, try to put ourselves and make things that God never made for us, and make up stories and things to threaten each other or feel funny about ourselves. And God is saying, no, you are my son. You are my daughter. You are the head and not the tail. You are above and not beneath. And you will lead, others will follow. Stop building up stories that are not real. Turn to your neighbor. Say, stop. Stop building up stories that are not real. Put those hands together for the Lord. And the strange thing that happened was that the men do not even pay attention to the woman. But fear caused this man to build up stories. And he was lying. Now pay attention. He sinned now against God in the midst of the promise. Pay attention now. But still, in the midst of his sin, God did not condemn him. God is such a merciful, loving Father. He did not accuse him. See what happened. See what happened. The Bible says, Abimelech raised up a decree. Say, whoever touched this man or his wife shall be put to death. Can you imagine? This was, listen now, this shows that the hand of God was upon this man. The glory was upon this man for a king to decree over you and your wife. Such a decree, and you are a foreigner. You're from a strange land. Could I say, please don't go there. But he says, if you touch them, you will die. Imagine that. It means that the hand of God was upon him. But yet, he was still underestimating himself. And sometimes the problem that we have is not with God, it's with our own very self. You are your own enemy. Oh, I don't think I can, I don't think I would, and I don't think I should, of which you can do much more. The Bible says, unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you may ask or think. Excuse me. Praise God. Hallelujah. God is able to do above all that you will ask or think. He sinned against God. In verse 9, the Bible says he lied. In verse 10, the Bible says Abimelech made a decree. And the Bible says in verse 11, the decree was settled. Now see the beginning of all beginnings. God is about to fulfill his promises in the life of this man. Let's see verse 13, 12. Let's take it from there. After the decree from Abimelech, verse 12. Then Isaac sowed in that land, in a strange land, right? That very land, he sowed in that land. Which land? The land that God says he should stay. Now, pay attention. Does it mean that Isaac was a lazy man? Careless man?
he had the promises of God, he did not cross his hands and legs and say, amen, amen, amen. That's what we do in churches. Amen, amen, amen. And we go home also. Amen, amen, amen. No job, amen. No business, amen. No income, amen. No school, amen. Everything, nothing, amen. No wonder you are like that. Amen, sister, amen, brother, amen. Nothing to show for. Nothing to show. What do you have? Nothing. Can't pay bills. Can't take care of yourself. Can't do anything. Why? You just, all your life is just belief. Now, faith without works is dead. Sometimes you need to get up and work. Amen? Turn to your neighbor. Say, get up and work. Look for a job. Get busy. Mm-hmm. When you talk about business, you should have the best business. Talk about job, you should be the manager there, the supervisor, the coach, or whatever. Don't cross your hands and say, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I'm hungry. Feed me. You will have nightmare. You're going to have nightmare. Praise God. With all the promises of God upon his life, the Bible says he got to the field. He was planting agriculture. The man was not just a lazy man. With the anointing, with the glory, with the grace, with the favor, with the power of God upon your life, if you are a lazy man, you're not going anywhere, plus your anointing. You're not going anywhere. The blessing of God will still hang upon you and it's not going to work. Why? You have to activate it. Now listen, the Bible says the Lord will bless the work of your hand. So if you don't put your hand, you don't work, no blessing. That is what God is going to bless. Are you getting it? So every member must have a job. Go work. Turn to your neighbor and say, go work. Look for a job. Put those hands together for the Lord. Hallelujah. It says Isaac sowed in that land. The man was busy with the promise. He did not stay idle. He acted on it. You see, do you know that when you take your legs and your hands and involve yourself doing something, it's a sign of belief and faith that you believe that is why you're working on what you believe on. Yes. But don't sit there and say, I believe, I believe. No, faith without works is dead.